come on down front. I know some of y'all ain't never been this close to the front, so it may be startling to you, but it's going to be okay.
Thank you.
God. As a matter of fact, over and over again, I've been asked that. And over the past 4, 5, 6 weeks, we've talked about that. This last message, I think it goes hand in hand with the graduation message. Because a lot of times, when you graduate high school and you go off to college, you get away from God. Especially if you go to a secular school. Let me just tell you, Liberty University is still taking applications. I recommend that because you will not get away from God if you go to Liberty. But be that as may, what happens, you see, it says, I'm saved, so what now? What now? You need to stay focused so you don't drift away. Now, whether you're a high school graduate, college graduate, parent, grandparent, it doesn't matter who you are, it's easy to drift away from God. And I'll tell you a little story about fishing. How did y'all ever guess I was talking about fishing? But I was on the Philpott Lake by myself, and that's up in Hickory County, Patrick County, right in that area, up in the mountains, and I had my boat, and it was kind of cool outside. It was like fall, late fall, water starting to get cold. And the thing about Philpott Lake is there's little docks everywhere that are public docks, like first come, first serve, and it's your dock for the day. So we love it because we get out there and we grab us a dock and then we be living the life. But this day I was by myself and I was fishing, and as it happens, nature calls. And so I had to dock the boat at one of my little piers and go for a nature hike. And the thing that happened was when I jumped off the boat, I was kind of in a hurry because it was starting to get a little serious. And so when I thought I secured my boat good to the dock, but it was still and calm. The wind was not blowing. The water looked like a sheet of glass. And I wasn't too concerned about the boat, so I just like threw the rope. Jumped off and went for a hike. And strange thing happened. Because I looked at it like, it'll be okay. So I took off running and I come back and the dock was right here and my boat was way down coming. Boat had just drifted away. Even though it was calm water, it looked like a sea of glass. Not a wave in sight. And I suspect if I'd have looked real close, I'd have seen my boat slowly drifting, but it was drifting so slow, because I was looking at it, and it looked like it was just sitting still, but when I got back, it was way out there. And so what do? When the boat floats away from the dock, and you're like 20 miles from the boat ramp, and there's only one thing you can do. Get wet. And when it's like October, then the water's pretty cold. So, long story short, I got my boat, and I got really cold and really wet, and it was a really short fishing trip. But all because I didn't watch my boat, and it just drifted away. But that's what happens with our relationship with Jesus. The water can be calm, no storms in sight. But the whole time, we're slowly drifting away from God. And before you know it, God's way over there and you're way out here. And you're like, what happened? I don't know. It's kind of like the story of the old married couple that was driving to church. They've been married for about almost as long as me and Christy, about 60 years. And they are. That's our joke, isn't it? And they were going to church and the wife said, I don't know what's wrong with you. When we first got married, we drove to church. We were so close together that you couldn't drive a broom straw between us. And the man said, well, you know what? I'm still driving. I ain't moved. So what happened? The same thing applies to God. God hasn't moved. God is in the same place he's always been. If anybody's drifted, it's us. So I think the perfect verse to illustrate this chapter 2. If you have your Bibles, I wish you'd turn with me there to Hebrews chapter 2. We're going to look at the first three verses. Just three little verses there in the book of Hebrews. It's interesting. Does anybody know who wrote the book of Hebrews? Yeah, if they knew, I would like to know how you know. Nobody else knows who actually wrote this book. We can guess at who wrote it. Could have been Paul, could have been Luke, could have been Apollos. We don't know. But it was a really smart person who wrote this who used extremely good Greek grammar, a lot better than I can grasp sometimes. But he was very educated, and he's writing to these people who are at risk of falling away from God. And so he writes in Hebrews chapter 2, verses 1 through 3, he says, "Therefore, we ought to give more earnest heed to the things which we have heard, lest at any time we should drift away." Or your Bible could say slip. Various translations have different words there, but it means to drift, to slip. In verse 2 says, "For the word spoken by the angels was steadfast, and every transgression and disobedience received a just recompense of reward." Verse 3, "How shall we escape if we neglect so great a salvation, which at first began to be spoken by the Lord and was confirmed to us by them that heard him?" Let's go to the Lord. Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you for our graduates. Lord, we pray that you would walk with them all the days of their lives, Lord. I pray that you would help them not to drift away from you, Lord. And don't just help the graduates. Help us all, Lord, to stay anchored to you, Father God. Show us how we can remain close to you, Lord. It seems like when we do drift away, it's in such small increments and such baby steps that we don't even notice it. At the time, it's only until later that we realize what has happened. So, Lord, help us today. Open up our hearts to receive your message. Lord, open our ears to be attentive. Help us to keep an open mind. And Lord, I pray you would send your Holy Spirit to anoint this place so that we can receive the message that you have for us, Lord. And let the message be not mine, but let it be yours. In Jesus' name. Amen. Yeah, that first verse is very powerful. It says, "Therefore, we must pay closer attention to what we've heard, so that we don't drift away." And when my dad he died when I was young, he was not a good dad. I don't have many fond memories of, if any. I have a lot of bad memories of him. But one memory I do have involves church. And my dad would go up in church, and he would snore louder than anybody I'd ever seen in my life. And nobody would ever say anything to him. He would just snore right through the sermon, and the preacher would just steadfast. Oh, if it was me and y'all start snoring like that, I'd come back and shake him or something. But he would just snore, and always, I didn't have the courage to ask him like this, "Didn't you sleep last night? I mean, is that the only place you can find to sleep is in church?" But you know what? If he would have just been paying attention to, maybe the preacher was born. I was so young, I can't remember. But I think if he would have paid a little bit more attention, he might not have fallen asleep. The first verse here says, we ought to give more earnest heed. We ought to pay attention a little bit more to the things we have heard. Now, what have we heard? Well, I'll tell you what you're going to hear this morning. You're going to hear about Jesus. You're going to hear about how good God is. I mean, Jesus Christ is my Savior. He is the one that changed my life, and I want you to know about it. I want you to hear about it. We ought to give more earnest heed or give closer attention to. Now the Greek word that this comes from is a word called proshito. It kind of sounds kind of like what we have as an appetizer at the Italian restaurant. Prosciutto, but it's a little different. So it's very, very close. It don't matter about the pronunciation. It matters about what it means. And how do you do it? Well, it starts with paying attention to what you hear right here in church, to what God is telling you, to what God is doing in your life. Pay closer attention to these things. The Bible says if you don't do that, then something's going to happen. You're going to drift away. Now, nobody wants to drift away from God. We all want to be close to God, but let me tell you, when you quit watching out, when you quit paying attention, that's when you drift away. So what exactly does it mean to drift away? I wondered about that. Well, when you drift away, it's just like my boat. It didn't just take off all at once. It was a gradual thing. It's a slow thing. It's baby steps. Like today, you say, well, you know what? I ain't got time to do my devotion. I'm just going to work. Or you get home, I might read my Bible, but you know what? I want to check out Facebook, so I'll read my Bible some. Somebody will post something on Facebook out of Scripture in it anyway. I don't need to read my Bible. It's a slow process. It's not fast, but what happens? Slowly, you start giving up what you once believed. You see, some people believe that reading God's Word makes a difference in their life. Some people believe that coming to church and hearing God's Word proclaimed will make you stronger so you can overcome those fiery darts of the enemy. Some people believe that God is a miracle worker. Anybody believe that this morning? I believe God is in the miracle working business. I believe He can do great things. And it also means that you just give up. So many people start out strong, but then you get up in college, and then your professor is going to tell you how the earth is like 90 quintillion trillion years old, and how we come from monkeys, and you know, the fossil record and all that stuff, and God ain't nothing but a crutch for humanity. It's like something for weak people. That's what they're going to tell you. It takes a strong person to take all that in and then to put it out. And remember that God is who He says He is. And let me tell you, I know some people make a good case that they come from monkeys. But it's not true. I didn't come from no monkey. I come from God. God formed me in my mama's womb. And even before that, He formed Adam out of the dust of the ground. And it didn't take no million years. It didn't take no billion, trillion, quintillion years to do it. If you trace the lineages from Matthew all the way back to Adam, it can't be no more than 10,000 years old. Don't tell your professor that, because he ain't going to like that. He's going to make you think you're as dumb as a box of rocks if you talk about that. You tell him, look, that don't make no sense to me, but my Bible makes plenty of sense. He's going to make you out like you're an idiot. But you know what? You know what the greatest thing, the greatest achievement in my Christian walk was? It's when I quit caring what other people thought about me. Oh my gosh, I thought I was a spiritual giant. Because I would tell my friends, you know what? Jesus loves you. And they'd be like, what are you on? What have you been doing? You on that Jesus stuff. I said, yep, I'm on that Jesus stuff. And more than I'm on it, He's in me. And He's changed my life. And I don't care what you think about it, because I care about what God thinks. You know, if the world would care more about what God thought about things than what your friends think about things and what people think about things than what your professor thinks about things, the world would be a better place. You got to think for yourself. Don't let Facebook think for you. Facebook will tell you what they want you to believe and how they want you to act and how they want you to dress. But look, I got something better than Facebook. This comes from God right here. And it's a perfect direction for your life. But you can't drift away. You give up reading your Bible this morning. Tomorrow morning, and don't let me get started about church. Because, you know, you miss one Sunday. How easy is it to come to church the next Sunday? That's tough, ain't it? Yeah, next Sunday comes around, you know you need to go to church. But Sunday, you get a little crust around your heart. And then that crust makes you a little insensitive to the Holy Spirit when He convicts you. And what happens? You drift away. Then that next Sunday comes, and you got that crust around your heart because you missed. And then that next Sunday comes, and you say, you know what? Them people gonna look at me funny when I ain't been there and I come back, so I'll just stay at home again. And then what happens? Bam. You drift a little further away. Then you let that happen for a couple months, and God's way over yonder, and you way over here, and you say, I don't know what happened. God used to be blessing me, and He was working in my life, and now it seems like God ain't doing much no more. What have you been doing for God? You know, it works both ways. God's a rewarder of those who seek Him. You got to seek Him. He's not going to come after you and drag you back into church. Somebody told me one time, God's a gentleman. He ain't going to force Himself on you. But if you will accept Him and you'll seek Him, you will find Him. See, there's all kinds of examples of people drifting away in the Bible. I just want to talk to you about a few. It says, For the word spoken, verse 2 here, for if the word spoken by angels was steadfast, and every transgression and disobedience received a recompense of reward. Well, what does that mean? Well, it means that you are rewarded based on how you behave. And I've mentored a lot of people in my life. Most of them have been nephews to me. And I've got a lot of nephews, and they're all about the same age, which is young and hard-headed and thinks they know everything. And so I will try to tell them this one thing. Consequences. One word, one thing. If you don't remember nothing else, consequences. You reap the consequences of your action. If you do good things, guess what's going to happen? Good consequences. If you do bad things, guess what the consequences are going to be? Y'all say, bad. See, y'all get it, right? It's going to be bad. If we could just learn that one simple thing, I think that's worth like 3 credit hours in college just to learn that. If I do bad stuff, I can expect bad results. But if I do what God tells me to do, I live my life like God says I should, then more than likely God's going to bless me. Wow. That's very profound, ain't it? Coming from old redneck country boy. That's some profound stuff right there, ain't it? But it's true. And the angels are no different. You see, the angels drifted away from God. I don't know if y'all know this, but back in the Garden of Eden, and when God created things, everything was in perfect harmony. He had 3 angels. Anybody know their names? Gabriel, Michael, Lucifer. Had 3 angels, and they had a third. They were like the archangels, and they each had a third of the angels under their control. Well, Michael and Gabriel were good old boys, and they was in God's word, and they was living life like they ought to, and so naturally, their consequences were what? Good consequences. But there's this one archangel. He had a little problem. He started drifting away from God. And I'm sure it was slow. He didn't realize what was happening. But, you know, he got to drifting away from God, and he started complaining about God. He said, you know what? Why am I doing all the work and he's getting all the reward? I don't like that. Then he started telling his angels, y'all know what? That ain't right. I don't like what he's doing. And he started drifting a little further away from God, further and further. And then finally, this archangel named Lucifer, he says, you know what? I'm tired of it. I ain't taking it no more. We're going to dethrone God, and I'm going to be God. I'm going to sit where God sits, and he's going to be working for me. Y'all with me? And his third angel said, yeah, sounds like a great idea. Because they had, you know, because they were listening to somebody who was drifting away. And what did it cause them to do? They drifted. It's like, what is that country song where he talks about tying up the boats to all in a row and having a floating party? I can't remember the name away from God, you're going to be drifting right along with the redneck yacht club. Away from, not to say all redneck yacht clubs are bad. But man, I'm easily distracted. So basically what happened was the angels, they rebelled against God. And when that happened, I mean, was that a good thing to do or a bad thing? It was bad. So what kind of consequences are they going to get? Bad, yeah. And 2 Peter says, "For if God spared not the angels that sinned, but cast them down to hell and delivered them into chains of darkness to be reserved unto judgment." This is what God did to his angels. He cast them down to hell. He put them in chains. They're in them chains right now because they rebelled against God. Now, their leader, he's not in chains right now. He's roaming the earth seeking those who he can destroy. He even still has access to heaven right now. But guess what? He's not an archangel anymore. He's been cast down from that exalted position. Bad decisions bring bad consequences. And he's not the only one. The Bible says, it goes on to say, "And he spared not the old world, but saved Noah." There was an old world. Did you know that? It was a world that existed, and it was the pre-flood world. God called Noah one day, and this is a time when there had never been rain. They'd never seen rain before. Never seen rain and never seen a boat. God calls up Noah, and he says, "Noah, let me tell you something. It's getting ready to rain like it did in Tappahannock last night, but like for 40 days of that." Whew. Can you imagine? And I'm sure Noah's like, it is? What's rain? Because they've never seen rain before. He said, "Don't worry about what it is. Let me tell you what I want you to do. I want you to build a boat so you can survive." And Noah's like, "Build a boat? What's a boat? You've never seen a boat before. Don't worry about what it is. I'm going to tell you how to do it. I'm going to give you the directions on how to do it." Now, I'm running out of time real quick, so I'm going to pretty much end it on this right here. If you don't want to drift away from God, if you want to stay close to God, he might ask you to do something that you ain't never done before. He might ask you to prepare for some rain to come, and you ain't never seen rain. He might ask you to build a boat, and you ain't never seen a boat before. He might ask you to step out on faith and give a gift like you've never given before. He might ask you to step out on faith and teach a class. He might ask you to step out on faith and give your soul to him. He might ask you to do crazy things that you don't know how to do. But guess what? You ain't got to know how to do it. You just got to be willing to do it when he gives you the instructions. Because if he asks you to do something, he's sure enough going to empower you to do it, and he's sure enough going to give you the how to do it. But you see, you got to be close to him. You got to remain in his word. You got to give heed. You got to pay attention to what God's doing in your life. And y'all know me. I've been on a little tangent here lately, and I like it because I've seen a lot of results. And you know these little things right here, they're supposed to be for your tithes and offerings. And that's okay. If you want to put some money in there, that'll be good. But let me ask you to do this right here. Or a visitor card, everywhere you want to write it. Or even if you filled out one, you fill out another one for this. So the whole premise here is that God wants you to pay attention. Because he's obviously working some way in your life. So I want you to write on this card what God wants you to pay attention to. Write on this little card, envelope, whatever it is. What do you think God wants you to pay attention to? You ain't got to put your name on it or nothing. I just want you to write that down. What do you think God wants you to pay attention to? And then the second thing I want you to write on there is, what is the number one thing that is causing you to drift away from God? Now, I'll tell you what. Statistics say that unless everybody is writing something, nobody ain't going to write nothing. So I want everybody to hold one of these in their hand right now and hold a pencil in your hand. And look, I don't care if you don't do nothing but scribble circles to drift away from God. Because if we're honest, we've all got something that's pulling us away from God. Something that wants us to drift away from God. Think about it. Write that down on this piece of paper. And I'm going to tell you, you can either give it to me or just drop it in that offering plate along with your building fund money on the way out. And I'm going to pray over each and every one of these like I've been doing with all the other ones. I'm going to pray for you. Like, if you want to write your name, that's fine. If you don't, I'm still going to pray for every single one of these. I'm going to pray for you that God will confirm what he wants you to do. And I'm going to pray that God will take away any stumbling stones that are causing you to drift away from him. So, I'm going to give you just a few seconds to write those down while I take a drink of water. Saying to us, because you're speaking to all of us, Lord, one way or another.